Hello, welcome everybody. So thanks so much for coming out today. We're doing a book event, as you know, for Drone Wars, which is a book that in some ways came out of a conference that was jointly organized by Arizona State University and New America in this space. And it's been sort of a long time coming, and we have the honor of having six of the contributors presenting different aspects of their work. So really briefly, we're dividing into two panels. The idea is we're going to have sort of brief presentations from each contributor and then open the floor for questions. So the first panel, we'll talk about what is drone warfare and how did it come to be. So we're going to hear from Peter W. Singer, strategist and senior fellow at New America. Peter is the author of multiple award-winning books, a contributing editor at Popular Science magazine. He's been named by the Smithsonian Institution National Portrait Gallery as one of the 100 leading innovators in the nation, by Defense News as one of the 100 most influential people in defense issues, and by Foreign Policy Magazine to their top 100 global thinkers list. We're also joined in this panel by Christopher Swift. Christopher is an adjunct professor of national security at Georgetown, where his research focuses on terrorism, armed conflict, and the intersection between constitutional law, international law, and national security. He also practices law at Foley and Lardner, where he's a member of the White Collar Litigation Group. And then finally, we'll hear from Michael Waltz. Mike is a lieutenant colonel in the U.S. Special Forces. He's also a senior fellow here at the International Security Program at New America. He's the president of Metis Solutions, that provides strategic analysis, policy development, intelligence support, and foreign commercial development to the U.S. government. Before we move on to each of the speakers, and what each speaker will just discuss a theme related either to their contribution in the book or to some pressing issue related to drones that they want to speak about. But one thing I want to let all of you know is that this project, the Drone Wars Project, and what began being known here as the Year of the Drone, and then expanded at New America to the Decade of the Drone, has now taken us to a new project, which is called the Future of War Project, which involves a formal relationship between Arizona State University, where I teach, and it includes right now over 90 faculty members at Arizona State, and then also New America. It's a linkage with a Future of War team that is based here, and then a series of affiliated faculty in ASU. We will have our big launch on February 24th and 25th. We're gonna have a major conference here in Washington, D.C., and you will hopefully hear about that. And then hopefully you'll hear over time about some of the different programs, projects, and sort of outcomes from this Future of War Project. What's interesting about it is that the term Future of War and our research concerns have very much grown out of grappling with drones, not just drones as the tools that they are and the machines that they are, but the sorts of complex questions that are raised by drone use and that have become, you know, they've become indicative of this sort of moment in the projection of U.S. power where drones have been so significant. And when I say so significant, one thing to keep in mind as we move forward is not just our interest in drones being related to the drones themselves, but after, you know, over 13 years of significant conflict, for some reason, drones are the only military technology that's captured the popular imagination. And we may not have a single answer for why that's the case, but that seems to be true. And that's a good starting point for trying to work through the sorts of questions that come out of our engagement with drone wars. So let's hear first from Peter Singer.
Great. Well, first, thanks for having me. And I'm definitely excited about the new project that we're launching with ASU. I thought I would hit the idea of what's changing in the discourse and policy side over drones. My own entry point into this that started the book that I did, Wired for War, back in 05 was a conference in DC. The title of it was looking at what is changing in warfare. And it was in 2005, and it was one of these Pentagon-sponsored events, 2 days worth of meetings at the Reagan building to give you a sense of the size, everything from four-star generals to Pentagon officials to all the top wonks in town. And for 2 days, they talked about what's changing in war. And over those 2 days in 2005, the word drone, the word robot, the word unmanned was not used once. Then I joined the Obama campaign and helped coordinate their defense policy task force. And during that period, I was working on a book on robotics, unmanned systems, wired for war. And it was kind of made clear, hey, keep that quiet. That's a really crazy, zany topic. That's not a serious thing to be talking and exploring the use of drones and unmanned systems in war. There's an irony in that, of course, in terms of how much that's become known related to the administration's kind of foreign policy. But the point is that was the discourse then. And in 2009, after the book came out, I remember meeting with a senator where I had to explain to him that no, there was not a little man inside the cockpit of a Predator, that it was too small to fit someone like that. That was the discourse. That was the awareness of drones in these various spaces. Now, here we are today, where, you know, as you talked about it, we've gone from the year of the drone to the decade of the drone, whatnot. And I think we're seeing a couple of key changes. I would say that it's really three. One is that the technology itself is evolving, its size, its shape, its form. We're seeing everything from insect size systems to unmanned systems with planes the length of a football field. We've gone from them being viewed as utterly remotely piloted, as the Air Force describes them. That's the way you operated the MQ-1 Predator. To now they are able to do more and more on their own, whether it's the ability of the MQ-9 Reaper to take off and land on its own, fly mission waypoints, to the X-47 UCAS, which is able to do the toughest human pilot task, take off and land from an aircraft carrier on its own. It's going to be doing air-to-air refueling on its own in the next year, to the tests that the British are doing with the Taranis that's doing target recognition and potentially strike on its own. Again, the human is not completely out of the loop. We're not entering the era of the Terminator, but the definition of the human role in the loop is changing, and that hits a lot of these issues of law and ethics that we want to talk about. That leads to not just a greater number of uses, but a greater number of users as they become more complex but easier to operate. And so that means not just in the military space this is shifting. You really can't find a military function right now that's not being roboticized in some way, shape, or form, whether it's front-end tactical operations to back-end logistics to medicine, but also the civilian use. We've seen everything from ISIS flying its own drones for surveillance to there is a test in, going on in Virginia soon on using drones for farming. That widespread use is hitting what Dan laid out as the way it's captured the public's imagination. And then there's also a feedback loop that's going on in the media where the media sees this and then is driving more news stories around it. The word drone is in media terms a heat word. If you see it in a headline, you're more likely to click on it. That's why we're seeing it so often. And so there's this loop going on. If you do a Google search right now, there's overall, the term drones used 88 million times. In the news section, it's 9 million times. And that's everything from an Atlantic article on killing machines to BBC just had an article out on the most stunning drone pictures of 2014. And that really hits the change that I think we're gonna see ultimately in this, is that it's becoming baked into our politics and discussions of law and ethics, where it's no longer an anomaly, but it's a full part of it to the point that we don't even think about it anymore. And I think we can see that in everything from our discussions of South Asia policy, where it's, you can't talk about American policy in Pakistan or Afghanistan right now without some discussion of this becoming part of it, to our overall
view of war itself to actually our use of cell phones himself. We can hear a robot talking back to us with Siri there. Our discussions in war itself, where right now we have ongoing operations in Iraq and Syria, where unmanned systems are simply put a natural part of the operation right now, to the point that we don't even notice that every video that you see of the strikes is one gathered for you by unmanned systems, including even the ones carried out by manned systems that supposedly were the only ones that could get there, but somehow we had an unmanned system there. So if you've seen, for example, the famous use of the F-22 stealth fighter finally in war, it was an unmanned system that took pictures of the strike. And that leads to this idea that, to steal a phrase from Brian Eno, the musician, he talked about how technology is a term that you use to describe something that you don't use every day. And once you use it every day, you no longer call it technology anymore. And I think drone is on its way to becoming that. That is, very soon we'll stop having articles about the top drone pictures of the year, and it'll just be the top pictures of the year. And in turn, just as we now have books on drone wars, the follow-up, as you laid out, will just be about war itself. This baking in of this term, this concept, is something that I think we have to face, like it or not.
Thanks so much. Christopher?
Good morning. Thank you all for the opportunity to be here and the opportunity to opine and hopefully share some insights from the field. In 2012, in the summer of 2012, I went to Yemen with the object of studying how al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula interfaces with indigenous tribal structures. I did not go with the intent of studying drones or drone warfare or the legal or ethical or operational controversies surrounding the same. But it was very difficult to avoid that issue when I was there, in part because one of the individuals I was going to witness, I was going to interview, got droned the night I was supposed to interview him. And also in part because every single one of the religious and tribal leaders that I spoke to in southern Yemen, out on the line between where the Yemeni army was advancing and where al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula had control of two provinces, the drones were very much on their mind. Now, the drones weren't on their mind in the way they're on our mind here in Washington, D.C. And what I'd like to do with my time this morning is try to give you a bottom-up perspective, a perspective from the theater. Every single individual I spoke to resented U.S. intervention in Yemen and hated the drones. And every single one of them told me, you have to continue the program. That may not make any sense to us sitting here in Washington, where the issue is an ethical issue, or it's a legal issue, or it's a CIA versus JSOC issue, or a Title 10 versus Title 50 issue. But if you're in a community that is seeing its young men drawn into al-Qaeda by virtue of economic inducement, if you're in a community where traditional tribal and social structures are breaking down because of the intervention of this outside group, your equities are very different from the equities that we consider here in Washington. Now, what were those equities? Well, the equity, first off, was security. Second off was community. And third was really the sense of resentment and sovereignty. But in the near term, individuals that were fighting al-Qaeda door-to-door in their own villages or seeing their young men recruited away into the organization were very keen on the need for someone to come in and help them solve the problem. They didn't necessarily trust the Yemeni government to do it. They didn't necessarily trust the neighboring tribe to do it. They didn't like that we were doing it, but they didn't want us to stop. It's a very, very complicated set of circumstances. And those very complicated set of circumstances bring us into some of the comments that you made earlier about the distinction between the nature of the instrument and the nature of the war itself. The instrument is an interesting, provides us with a set of interesting capabilities. We can stay on station for a longer period of time. We can surveil and collect intelligence. We can use that intelligence in real time against an actual target in the theater with very light footprint and very high return on investment and very low risk to actual troops. The difficulty is if we buy into the technology as a panacea in terms of solving these, complex small wars in faraway places, we completely forget the fact that we're still engaged in a war. And we completely forget the nature of war itself. And, you know, as Clausewitz taught us, war has a tendency to serve itself if it's not bound by policy. And one of the ways we bind war with policy is understanding who our adversary is, where our adversary is, and who our adversary is not. And I think to the extent that you've seen problems in Yemen and Pakistan and elsewhere with the targeting of particular individuals and groups, it's been because we have a broader problem of defining the adversary in the global war on terrorism and a much deeper problem of not having relationships in these countries where we intervene and operate that go beyond the English-speaking elites in the capital. We see it in Yemen, we see it in Pakistan. That brings me back to a bigger question, and that is, whenever you're involved with war, whether it's a small war or a big war, whether it's by remote control or on the ground, there are political and social consequences that attend to the use of organized violence, especially when it's the use of organized violence in somebody else's country. So it's very clear that we need to keep those things in mind, both from a strategic perspective and from a policy perspective when we're using these instruments, rather than fetishizing the instrument itself. Right? It's not the drone that causes the problem, it's the policy and the choice to use an instrument in furtherance of that policy that may create a problem. You know, one of the problems that we perceive in a theater like Yemen is that the drones recruit for Al-Qaeda. Well, I can tell you that every individual I spoke to in Yemen, with the exception of two, told me that it's actually local economic inducement that's recruiting for Al-Qaeda. If you can pay $200 a month or $400 a month in a $60 a month economy, that's a game changer for an 18-year-old. It's a game changer for a head of family. It's a game changer for a tertiary tribal leader who maybe has been cut off from traditional sources of patronage. So that's where the recruiting is happening. It's not happening because of drone strikes. What the drone strikes are doing, though, is they're giving people who are resentful of U.S. intervention in Yemen spoilers in the political process, not limited to Al-Qaeda, an opportunity to raise these bigger questions about who is intervening in our country, how are they intervening, and where is our agency in this war that we're fighting on our own soil. That brings me back to a broader question about the character of our debate in Washington. We tend to look at this either as a liberty versus security issue, as if liberty and security were somehow some sort of dichotomy and the two couldn't be reconciled. They can indeed be reconciled, and the way we reconcile it is with law, and the next panel is going to address that more broadly. But it also really underscores the fact that we're focused on the platform and not the bigger failures in our policy, the failure to identify our adversaries, the failure to develop relationships on the ground that are sustainable over a long period of time, that would give us the insight we need to distinguish between, you know, an American who's been kidnapped by Al-Qaeda and an American who might be running, like I was, running around in the back of a truck with a bunch of tribal guys who's there to research Al-Qaeda. We don't have that kind of ability to distinguish right now. And if we don't have that kind of granular understanding of what's going on, you can understand the difficulties that, you know, would flow from engaging in warfare by remote control. The final thing that I want to do is sort of set out a framework, and it's a framework that's not just relevant for the drone issue. It's also relevant to the torture report issue we see in Washington this week, and relevant, if I can say as much, more broadly to how we execute policy and strategy in the war on terrorism. And the framework is threefold. First, is the operation that we're engaging in legal? Is it legal under international law? Right? Have we taken care of the sovereignty and the Geneva issues in the theater where we're operating? And is it legal under U.S. law? Is anyone exceeding their authority or undermining some fundamental constitutional right? As long as you can cover both of those things off, in my standpoint, you've checked the first box in terms of this three-part framework. The second is it effective? Right. Well, one of the ways drones are most effective is not in taking out high-value individuals or terrorist, you know, group leaders. It's in hollowing out the middle management in a terrorist group in order to dissociate the high leadership from the foot soldiers. It's a form of attritional warfare. That's what we did with high success in Pakistan. That's what we have been doing with a fair amount of success in Yemen, notwithstanding the civilian casualties. So we need to understand that when we're measuring efficacy, exactly what efficacy we're measuring. And then the third question is it wise? And what I mean by that are there unintended consequences or externalities that still attach even if your operation is legal and effective? And that's really where you need to know a place. You need to know a place from the ground up and not from the outside in. In the case of Yemen, the externality is our success in the drone program wasn't recruiting for Al-Qaeda, but it was undermining some of the intertribal and interfactional, you know, diplomacy we were trying to organize through the GCC framework, and you see that even today. So understanding these things from the ground up is key. Not getting caught in our false dichotomy between liberty and security and those old debates that go back to the Vietnam War here in Washington is key. And this three-part framework, is it legal, is it effective, is it wise, should be a better, in my view, approach to dealing with some of these issues. If something's legal and effective, it's probably wise. If something's effective and wise, it should probably be legal. But if something is not legal and not effective, how could it possibly be wise? Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Very briefly, for those who are tweeting, please use hashtag Drone Wars. One thing before Mike speaks, I wanted to bring up something about the book. Part of our goal here is to focus the attention on the book Drone Wars. So it's divided into four sections. The first is drones on the ground. The second is drones and the laws of war. The third is drones and policy. And the fourth is drones and the future of war. We have a pretty strong commitment to interdisciplinarity in our ASU New America linkage and in the Future of War project. And the reason I'm saying all this before Mike speaks is that each of the four sections begins with a personal narrative, one of David Rode talking about what it was like to be held by the Taliban for 7 months and how his captors responded to drones, another of a drone pilot, Nellis Air Force Base in Nevada, another of a local in North Waziristan, and one of them is Mike, speaking about what drone deployment was like for somebody on the ground in special forces. I bring that up just to give you a sort of lead into the book, encouraging you to get it, but even if you don't, you'll have a sense of this kind of structure that we're after to combine personal narratives and direct experience with kind of high-level policy analysis and legal analysis from both scholars, practitioners, scientists, and others. So, Mike.
Thank you. So I'll just start with a simple statement in that I love drones. Love them. I would not be here, hands down, would not be here talking to you today without them. Nor would many of my soldiers in the Special Forces community or many of our folks deployed overseas. They've saved my life and they've saved many others. And I welcome a conversation like this to talk about the broader policy framework that drones fit into. But as I'll talk to in a minute, I think we need to be very careful about confusing a tool for the policy debate, and I commend your statements on, you know, often it becomes, drones have become a shiny object for folks who disagree with the policy, but at the end of the day, it really is a tool, and it's a darn effective one. So one of the reasons that it's been so effective is that it's very precise. It allows us to put eyes out on the battlefield, which we've been trying to do from a military perspective since men were going up in balloons in the Civil War. And it allows us to do things that, frankly, we just couldn't do before. I served out in Afghanistan in 03, 05, and 09, and really saw the evolution of having more and more of this capability available to us. And I'll talk to you today. And frankly, net-net, it was very, very beneficial to our effort, despite a lot of the, kind of think, some of the media around it. The first thing it allowed us to do was to really get a pattern of life for some of the Taliban commanders and Al-Qaeda commanders that we were targeting. And often the goal of that pattern of life, so when I say that, that's we would have continuous drone orbits over where we thought they were located. Often we weren't quite sure, so part of those orbits were to nail down where they were located before we either launched a special forces raid or launched an attack from the drone itself, or sent in the Afghan National Army or police on a raid themselves to arrest the individuals. The great thing is, in 2003, if we, our intelligence apparatus, kind of boiled this down, you know, the location of, you know, name the Taliban commander, Haqqani commander, what have you, boiled this down to four or five different locations, back in 2003, we would go into four or five different locations. By 2009, we could confirm the exact location, and we're often using the kind of pattern of life, this continuous surveillance, to time our intervention so precisely that we would time it when civilian casualties either or civilians weren't in the vehicle, family members weren't around, and would use it as a collateral damage mitigation tool. There's a lot of talk about drones associated with civilian casualties, and I'm here to tell you, as someone who's used them now for the better part of the decade out on the ground, it was often quite the opposite. We used them to avoid civilian casualties and to go into areas when civilians weren't around. Usually, I think from a pretty common sense perspective, that was in the middle of the night when people weren't out in the bazaar, weren't out in the village, and we could maximize surprise to these guys, which minimized the amount of firefights and the amount of collateral damage. So it's allowed us to do a lot of things as they've evolved. The other thing it's allowed us to do is from a kind of a force protection standpoint. A derivative of the drone is the aerostat or the blimp. You know, blimps, and to distinguish the difference, commonly blimps fly, they move around, and aerostat is tethered. So we would have in most of our bases by 2009 an aerostat up over the base with a camera that could have, you know, a wide area view around it. These things were wonderful. They would prevent common mistakes. For instance, you know, local villagers shooting off their weapons in celebration of a wedding or an event that could be mistaken for an attack. We could then see it with the aerostat, and we got so dependent on them, frankly. I was in one coalition base with some of our NATO partners, and whenever the weather was bad and that thing had to be pulled down, they were 100% manning the gates because they were, but when the weather was fine and it was up, you know, we could really go about a lot of the rest of our business. A great tool. And then the last thing I think it allows us to do, and I'll start edging into kind of the policy realm here, but it allows us to do things without troops that in the past we would have needed troops to do. So I know probably most of you here have seen the movie Lone Survivor, where you had four Navy SEALs out on a surveillance mission, literally with binoculars staring at a house. That was in 2005. My unit actually took over. The SEAL team was so devastated by, you know, by their losses that they were pulled out early, and we were accelerated in to take over that mission. A couple of years later, those guys wouldn't have been out. Those four guys wouldn't have been out with binoculars. We would have had a drone over that house. And I would argue that's a good thing. I talk about this in my contribution to the book, it allows us to, again, be much more precise in our operations. So, you know, I developed a relationship with an elder in Host Province in eastern Afghanistan. I worked with him in the early years, and he, you know, both he and his tribe vehemently opposed the Haqqani network and sought our support, which we gave. In the early years, whenever, bottom line is, whenever we were kind of opposing the Haqqanis or going after the insurgency, we would go in with platoons of infantry or Afghan National Army or what have you. By 2009, he was asking for what he called the magic. And what he referred to as the magic is, I mean, they had experienced by then when we went conducted a kinetic strike with a drone that literally a bedroom would blow up or a car amongst five cars would blow up. And from the village elder's perspective, whenever he wanted to rid, you know, he called it kind of ridding his valley of this cancer called the Haqqani network, which truly is just a criminal group and a group of thugs, he would rather it be done with an individual strike that targets that one individual rather than a platoon of the Afghan National Army or a brigade of American forces rolling through his valley. So by 2010, he was asking for the magic. Like, hold off, guys. I want a drone. From an Afghan elder's perspective. So it allows us to do things that very precisely and very remotely that normally we would have had U.S. troops doing. Now, take a step backwards. I was also, I worked as a civilian for Secretary Gates and Vice President Cheney as their South Asian and CT advisor in the Bush administration. And when we're looking at this from a policy perspective, if you buy into the notion that we have to counter al-Qaeda in their sanctuaries, and you buy into the policy kind of parameters of that, whether it's in Pakistan or Yemen or Somalia, what's your better option? Are we going to do that with a full force, boots on the ground intervention, or are we going to do that with drone strikes that target individual commanders very precisely? Not always perfectly. I think we all admit that there's collateral damage to civilians. It's very unfortunate. But I would certainly take that over the other policy options. So I would just encourage everyone as we're talking about drone warfare, you have to put it in the kind of broader perspective of, okay, if not drones, then what? You know, and the last thing I'll talk about is the fact that there is a human, I assure you, that there is a human at every level. I would argue and give some examples here in the book that there's probably too many levels of intervention when it comes to the use of drones. Technology has allowed a level of micromanagement out in the battlefield that I think is actually detrimental many times to what we're trying to do with small units in remote areas. Not only do you obviously have the drone pilot seeing what he's seeing, I usually would have a remote a viewer on the ground. As the ground force commander, I'm actually responsible. They force you to give your name and initials over the radio, and it's recorded that I'm seeing on the ground in addition to what the drone pilot's seeing before using kinetic force. In my view, that's no different than calling in an artillery strike. That's no different than, you know, using any other system to affect the enemy on the battlefield. But in addition, with drones, because you can send that feed anywhere, my boss sees what I'm seeing, his boss sees what he's seeing. I actually, in many operations, had folks all the way back in the Special Operations Command in Tampa and in one in the Pentagon seeing what I'm seeing and asking many questions. And standing next to each one of those commanders is a lawyer ensuring that what we're doing fits within their interpretation of the law of land warfare. So, you know, I just say that to refute this notion that there's these kind of remote things flying around zapping people. You know, it is you're making life or death decisions. Often it's our life or theirs. This is war. This is combat. And, you know, there are humans involved at every level. So I just say that to dispute that, and I think I'll stop, or just to dispute that common notion. And again, you know, in any discussion, I emphasize, if not drones, then what, as we're fighting this long war on terrorism. I'll stop.
So thank you so much, and we'll turn to all of you for questions. I don't know if technologically, is there a mic floating around, or should I just take one of these? There is one floating around. Great. Okay, so raise your hand. There we go. Laura.
Hi, I'm Laura Dickinson. I'm a professor at George Washington University Law School and also a Future of War Fellow here at New America. Most of you have focused on the policy implications of our offensive use of drones, either for intelligence gathering or targeting. Peter, you mentioned that ISIL has reportedly used drones and or potentially may use drones. I guess what I want to ask is about the implications of the proliferation of this technology. It's very cheap, and what are the policy implications of that for us, either overseas or even domestically? Thanks.
I'll hit that first, but please others weigh in. So it's a technology, again, it's fascinating to compare the discourse with the reality here. A year ago, I was invited to speak at a U.S. government-sponsored session at another think tank about how to prevent the proliferation of drones. And I was the awful guy at the start of the conference who said, sorry, they're already in the hands of 87 other countries. So, you know, how do you prevent, you know, we're done. They're already out there. And again, it's not just other states. It's non-state actors that range from, as you mentioned, ISIS to Hollywood paparazzi. So the implications of that are everything from military implications in terms of the U.S. military starting to wrestle with how does it defend against adversary use of unmanned systems against it, whether it is in state-on-state action. For example, it's not being baked. Well, I talked about how it's becoming baked into warfare. It's not being baked in enough into our concepts versus China, air-sea battle concept or doctrine, as you want to call it. That's actually what my next book is on, is looking at what is the next major war look like. And we have to assume that both sides will have high technology, not the advantageous way we've seen it so far, but also
things like air defense operations in what we could think of as hybrid or counterinsurgency. We haven't been thinking about adversaries like an ISIS or a Hezbollah or a Hamas. They've all got it right now. You have that to the legal and ethical and policy implications of our use of something setting precedents that others might either follow and or abuse, saying, oh, you did X, so therefore I can do it too. And we should expect that to happen with others' misuse of drone strikes. It's similar to what's playing out in the torture debate right now. There were states that were already going to do bad things that are now explaining themselves using the CIA report. China today came out that way. And we should expect the same thing to happen with unmanned systems. So I think that's some of the implications. There's one other thing, though, I wanted to be sure to lay out, and it'll hopefully connect to some of these questions and also the presentation here. I think I want to echo being very careful about smushing together unlike or different things or operations because of the same use of technology. That's right. And we actually did this up on stage, and I expect it to come in the questions, too, of talking about overt military use of the technology in an Afghanistan or an Iraq versus the not so covert operations in a Pakistan or a Yemen. So when we talk about everything from civilian casualties to rules of engagements to laws and authorities to how local civilians are reacting, be sure to distinguish between these. They operate under very different terms. It's the same technology, an MQ-9, but you might have everything from a different law than it's been authorized by. You definitely have a different set of lawyers involved who are looking with a different set of training. I'm the son of an Army JAG officer. They look at things, they follow different processes than a CIA lawyer does, to different accountability or not. So when airstrikes go bad in Afghanistan, there are investigations, there have been court martials. We have not had that on the not so covert side in a Pakistan. To the ROEs, the rules of engagement that you follow, things like a signature strike or a double tap, JAG officers would not authorize that. At least according to media reporting, that has happened in the not so covert operations on the civilian intelligence side. To the policy perspective of how we talk about it and what we authorize, the difference between boots on the ground versus how, for example, President Bush's former chief of staff described the decision to send in a very small team of Navy SEALs to go after the ultimate target, bin Laden. Just for those 30 minutes, he described it as the toughest call any president could make. Didn't talk about the more than 300 airstrikes into that same country in that same terminology versus sending, you know, we don't describe having multiple numbers of boots on the ground in that same discourse. So I just want to be very clear here. We need to be refined. We need to be careful about smushing together discussions of civilian casualties to authorities, to rules of engagement, when we're talking about very different things when it comes between overt use of it in military operations, what we think of as war, versus not so covert use by civilian intelligence agencies, which then we get into a debate over whether it's war or not. But let's not smush them together because they use the same technology.
Other questions? Let's just make sure we get a few more questions and then you can respond. Anybody else out in the audience with a, yeah, Kurt? You can just identify yourself and ask your question.
Thanks. Hi, Kurt Volker, lead the McCain Institute, also part of Arizona State University, work with Daniel, and formerly ambassador to NATO. And I want to pick up what Peter was just saying and push it in a slightly tougher direction. Because I agree, I think drones are just like any other piece of military equipment. You know, they do a job. The difference is that at a strategic level of decision making, we find it a lot easier to use a drone, and we go through, at least on the covert side, fundamentally different processes than we would for a normal military operation. So the risk that we run into is that we are tempted to engage with a drone where we wouldn't otherwise engage. That is an act of war that we're not calling an act of war, and not exercising the same degree of oversight in our own political process, and not providing an example for how an international community should have standards for how you engage in conflict like this. So I think that we have a lot to do, not on the technology or the military use of it, but a lot to do on the political oversight in our own system. I wonder if you might comment on that.
I want to, Ambassador Volker and Laura, I want to package some of your questions together. Laura, Peter's exactly right on the doctrinal and operational issues. Let's distinguish what happens in the theater from the broader policy. Looking to the legal implications, there are ways that you can deal with proliferation. One would be to revise the missile technology control regime with more focus on UAVs. That's what currently the international treaty that currently governs the proliferation of UAVs and like systems. So if you're interested in, you know, managing the proliferation issue, we can do it in conjunction with our allies through the MCTR. Getting to the policy issues, Ambassador Volker, I think you're exactly right. It may not feel like war to us, but it certainly felt like war when I was in Yemen. And for the Yemenis, it certainly felt like war. And so there's been a lot of debate about whether new technologies and new systems require new laws and new policies. And I would respectfully suggest that the problem we need to solve here is not a technological problem. It's a human problem. The fault is not in our stars, as Shakespeare would say, but in ourselves. And we've already solved these problems in the Geneva Conventions. We already have this body of law that tells us when and how we can use organized violence to achieve political ends. The amount of proportionality we need to use, the amount of discrimination we need to use, right? When and how and where we can engage that. Part of the difficulty we've had over the last few years, and you know, resonating with Ambassador Volker here, is the attempt to call something that is war not war, and therefore remove it from the normal Geneva oversights. Right? We've done that with torture, we've done that with drone strikes, we've done that with a number of other areas in the war on terrorism. Look, the laws and customs of war are not a restraint. Right? If they're used properly, they help mitigate harm on the front end and help keep war from expanding and serving itself. Right? And it's not just a bunch of lawyers sitting around in a room saying, you know, you can't do this, you can do that. It's a body of knowledge and experience that's been handed down to us from our grandparents and our grandparents' grandparents. It's the sum total of all of the mistakes they made in prior wars. And it's written down, and it's open source code for everyone in the world to read. So if I was going to fix something from a policy perspective in terms of the covert side of our program, I'd say, yeah, it's a Title 50 event, fine, but make sure it's subject to Geneva. Make sure it runs through the same processes that we would use if we were hitting a state target, right? That's one way of solving it. The other point I want to make in terms of the policy issue is really to emphasize the distinction that Peter's raised between the overt wars, the Title 10 events that special forces are doing in a conflict zone like Afghanistan or Iraq, where drones can be used for force protection and with a sort of a higher, you know, degree of permissibility because you're in an open acknowledged conflict zone versus a place like Yemen or Pakistan. The same rules need to apply, as far as I'm concerned from a legal perspective, where we're failing in places like Yemen and Pakistan, is we don't have the relationships that you were mentioning on the ground. Right? I interviewed a guy in Raqqa, which is one of the Al-Qaeda hotbeds. His tribe was leading, had formed its own militia to fight Al-Qaeda door to door in his own home village. They were taking fire every day. People were dying, right? That's not us, that's not the Yemeni government, that's the local tribal structure. He told me in no uncertain terms that he was willing to work with the United States and the Yemeni government if he felt he could trust us. But if we made a mistake and accidentally droned his people as opposed to the bad guys, there's no way his people could come on board with collaborating with us. I came back from Yemen 3 months later. We droned his people rather than Qaeda because we didn't have those relationships on the ground. Don't worry about the policy. Worry about the people. Worry about the people making the decisions, the people getting the information. That's where our system is broken down. That's where more oversight is needed. No panaceas, no silver bullets. This is a problem that takes us back to the Greeks 3,000 years ago.
Let's take two more questions for this panel so we can stick with it. Yeah, in the back.
I just wanted to jump in real quick.
Okay.
Absolutely agree. Are we prepared to then have the folks on the ground in Somalia, in Yemen, and in these places, and in northern Iraq, and in Syria, that we need to then build these relationships, right? And certainly is this administration ready to do it, given its stated policy? Couldn't agree more, and that's what kind of my tribe of Special Forces and our brothers over in the CIA really specialize in. But the flip side of that is I'd argue it would make the drones then even more effective.
Right.
The second piece, I just want to touch on the proliferation. You know, I work a lot through on the private sector with countries that are trying to, they want drones. But they're so focused right now, and, you know, oftentimes I tell them, stop, quit buying things. You know, quit just buying everything you can get your hands on, because what they'll do is they'll buy all of these things and then they'll come to us and ask them to craft a strategy around it. Like, let's figure out your requirements and what you want to do. Do you want to do border surveillance? Do you want to do internal surveillance? Do you want to do force protection for your military? Do you want to do projection? And then that'll drive the procurement. The reason I'm bringing that up is many, many of these countries where they're proliferating, yes, they're in 87. I would argue maybe about 5 can actually use them effectively. They're, and particularly in the irregular groups, you know, yes, Hezbollah has them. They're so focused on just making the thing fly. There's a whole other aspect to it. How do they then receive the feeds? How do they fuse it with all of their other intelligence? How do they do it in a timely manner that you can then make decisions? You know, all of those other pieces are what we've kind of learned over the last decade, and that drones are just one piece of an otherwise very broad intelligence picture that it's going to take a lot of these countries a very long, very long time to kind of get their wrap their mind around.
Major Thomas Eibel, I'm the Marine Corps University Law of War instructor. So having been one of those judge advocates who stands next to a commander and says, don't do that, don't do that. How would you recommend kind of combining those streams of on the overt and the covert side of potentially holding people responsible when they do make mistakes, or on the other hand, enabling people to be in a place where they can make decisions without making mistakes? And you talked about various layers and too many layers of management. And you talked about, Mr. Singer, about the various different factors that become involved, the different sets of laws, depending on what types of operations you are. Because right now we're talking about two separate legal
Title
systems.
Title 50 and Title 10.
Right. Yeah. So how would you avoid that?
I don't want to jump too much into the next panel, but I'd say the Title 10, Title 50 debate is another false dichotomy. Right? If you're talking about U.S. DOD forces conducting these operations, they're bound by Geneva no matter what. Doesn't matter whether making it a Title 50 event doesn't change the law and customs of war. It just changes the title of U.S. the U.S. code you're using and who you report to, who has to do the finding, whether the Gang of Eight gets it, whether the as versus you know Hask and Sask, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, the oversight and the mechanism is different, but the law of war, laws and customs of war still apply. In terms of bringing it together, and we need to stop seeing law as a restraint. And we need to start to see the law of war as a strategic system, mm-hmm. a way of mitigating unnecessary harm on the front end, managing and restraining your use of violence such that you're focused on your adversary, and more importantly, a way of identifying your adversary. I mean, look, we're 13 years into this war, more than 13 years into this war. I still have not seen any member of any administration, Republican or Democrat, come out with objective, consistent criteria for determining whether or not someone falls under the AUMF. Where are those criteria? Right? We have reverse engineered about 10 or 20 different groups into the AUMF over the last 13 years through, you know, 6 degrees of separation. Well, I can tell you that anybody that's met Peter Bergen is 2 degrees of separation away from Osama bin Laden, right? And I don't know how many degrees of separation. If I social network myself, it's like, you know, you'd think I was part of Qaeda, right? That type of analysis doesn't help us. What we need is objective criteria for determining who our adversaries are, and we haven't done that yet. And look, it goes back to the fundamentals of war, like we said earlier. You know, Clausewitz said that the first thing that a commander and statesman has to do when embarking on a war is to determine what kind of war they're getting into, not mistaking it for or turning it into something alien to its true nature. We haven't done that here. We haven't done that in the last 13 years, and that's why we're in the fix we're in.
Just to be clear, I mean, we're fighting in an irregular conflict. We're fighting an adversary that does not follow the Geneva Convention, that does not follow the accepted rules of land warfare, and we choose to. Mm-hmm. So there's a difference in fighting a state-on-state actor where both sides are abiding by the Geneva Convention. They are not, clearly, and we are taking the moral high ground and choosing to. So I just, yes.
Let me weigh in on that, please. And I think it also applies, again, yeah. And many of these things applies to the torture debate right now.
Exactly.
Just because the other side does or does not follow Geneva Conventions does not determine whether you do, exactly, both legally or logically, i.e., we had the classic state-on-state action of World War II, and the other side did not follow Geneva, but that didn't mean that we still shouldn't, or, but, you know, it's the progenitor to it. And we see that argument made repeatedly. And what I would say to you on the what can we do is, on the legal side, stop trying to fudge it. Stop trying to fudge Title 10 and Title 50. You see people talk about Title 60. It's, you know, there's no such thing, but that's a real term in the building on the Pentagon side. Stop trying to fudge in terms of moving units between back and forth. And stop, we on the flip side, outside of the JAG community, senior leaders need to stop blaming lawyers for the law limiting them from doing stupid policy decisions. And you know, I'll, and look, we can even go back to the decision not to air. We see the law blamed for policy decisions consistently when it's not the case. I'll leave it at that. It's frustrating, and you know, we're 13 years into this. We can get it right at some point, I hope.
And we'll have a retort, but we'll
just so we can give all panelists an even chance to chat. Let's thank our first panel.
This is just getting interesting.
And switch out for the next. Come on up. Maybe we'll have Konstantin just to keep with you go first, and then we'll hit up with as you
go.
Okay. So we're moving on to our next panel has the title of Law and Ethics of Drone Warfare, but as you can see, the first panel, not surprisingly, also engaged those questions. Very briefly, we have Konstantin Kakaes, who's here as a 2013 Future Tense Fellow and now newly managing a new drone project here at New America, dealing with international development and property rights. He's the author of the ebook, The Pioneer Detectives, Did a Distant Spacecraft Prove Einstein and Newton Wrong? I can say his piece in the Drone Wars book is a particularly illuminating one because it traces drones from sort of the era of the Wright brothers to the present and is quite illustrative of how not new key elements of the vision of drones, in fact, is. And it's a very well-researched and interesting piece. We also have Tara McKelvey, who's the White House reporter for BBC News, and she was a correspondent for Newsweek and The Daily Beast. She's also a frequent contributor to the New York Times Book Review and has authored Monstering, Inside America's Policy of Secret Interrogations and Torture in the Terror War. And then finally, Rosa Brooks, who is a senior fellow in the International Security Program and part of our Future of War project. A professor at the Georgetown University Law Center, where she teaches courses on international law, national security, constitutional law, and other issues. And she was the former counselor to the Undersecretary of Defense for Policy. So let's just move forward, and Konstantin.
Great, thanks, Daniel. So I wanted to start out by describing a UAV to you guys, which is one that's about 20 feet long, weighs about 3,000 pounds, it's got a 9-foot wingspan. It's GPS guided, has a satellite communications link, which the early versions did not. It's relatively low endurance. It's about 3 hours. travels relatively quickly, 500 miles per hour. Some of you may recognize it based on these flight characteristics. It's the Tomahawk cruise missile, which, as Chris Swift alluded, talking about the missile control, export control regimes, the distinction between cruise missiles and drones is an entirely artificial one of our own conception. Cruise missiles have a lot less in common with rockets because they're jet engines. They are planes that are quite bad at landing, because landing, it turns out, is one of the technically more difficult challenges, which is why the technology evolved in a way that then a policy evolved, that we will use this to do what it's good at, which is not worry about landing and just run it into something and have it explode. So in that sense, and the Tomahawk, for the record, sort of entered service in 1983, was used by Bill Clinton to attack Sudan and Afghanistan in 1998. And that attack wasn't as precise, didn't have the many long endurance characteristics that more recent drone strikes have had, but in my view is in character very analogous to the later drone strikes under the Bush and Obama administrations. Pete Singer mentioned that drone is a very clickable headline, which leads us to think sometimes that it's new. The X-37B, which was it's an Air Force space plane which landed in September, was often described as a space drone in headlines, which was to me a good example of sort of appropriation of a term because it sounds sort of shiny and futuristic and new. There's no way in which the X-37B was really a space drone in a way that Sputnik, you know, launched in the 1950s was not. We're used to having satellites flying overhead that are, you know, semi-autonomous in capability, that don't have people on them by and large, that accomplish surveillance missions. They tend not to bomb things, which is another can of worms. But our distinction sort of between what is and is not a drone tends to be a misleading one. A lot of the history of drones was also very secret at the time. So in the Vietnam War, there was a program called Buffalo Hunter, which was a total of $5.8 billion in 2010 dollars. Over 1,000 drones were built, 200 were lost in combat. It sort of picked up between 1970 and 1972. A sort of July 1973 Air Force report that was a sort of after-action report about Buffalo Hunter said that Buffalo Hunter has played an extremely important part in securing for us the BDA, that's the bombing damage assessment, of the strikes in the north. It was invaluable in the role. The general who was in charge of the program said, I know of no other way we could have obtained the information we needed. Linebacker 2 was a bombing campaign in North Vietnam that took place during the monsoon season when there was very heavy cloud cover. So it wasn't just that by the end of the Vietnam War, about 12% of total reconnaissance sorties were flown by drones. It was that 12% was getting information that the U.S. would have been otherwise unable to get. And that tends to be a chapter that if we think of drones as something that sort of sprung out of nowhere in the last 15 years, we're just flat out wrong. Another aspect in terms of, you know, what's new and what isn't, Daniel mentioned, he talks about sort of signature strikes, both earlier today and in the chapter in the book, which, because the initial usage of drones in Pakistan was targeted at individuals and then evolved into something that wasn't, we sort of discuss signature strikes as a new usage. If you look, another earlier use of drones in Laos, when there was the Pentagon spent about $1.7 billion, and that's 1968 dollars, so multiply that by, I don't know, a factor of 7 or 8, on a program called Igloo White to place 20,000 battery-powered sensors in the jungle in Laos, which was, again, just outside of an acknowledged military conflict, somewhat analogous, not precisely, but somewhat analogous to Pakistan and Afghanistan today. And those battery-powered sonar sensors, in conjunction with drone overflights, were used to target bombings at truck traffic, which, you know, you would assume that truck traffic was North Vietnamese military traffic, but you didn't actually know it for certain. So it was very much analogous to signature strikes today. Quickly, I don't want to take up too much time here, quickly mention, in the late 60s and early 70s, there were a series of National Reconnaissance Office drone overflights of China, which were, again, quite secret at the time, not very successful. So drones working as well as they do today is, in fact, new. Trying to get them to work is not, which is relevant in terms of if we think about how quickly the technology will evolve. If we think of it as something that just originated, we think it's changing really quickly. If we look at the history of failure, we understand that the change is a lot slower. Quickly addressing the issue of proliferation in terms of how the technology evolves. As Mike mentioned, you know, despite this figure of 87 countries have drones, very few of them use them effectively. That's not purely because they haven't had the savvy to evolve the doctrine. It's also because they don't have the global satellite telecommunications and positioning systems that we have. China, to some extent, does. Russia, to some extent, does. The European Union, to some extent, does. Nobody else does. Launching satellites is really expensive and difficult. It's getting cheaper. That's changing. It's not changing overnight. The extent to which the proliferation of drones will really matter in a substantive way depends on how the technologies of autonomy evolve. And that's an area which the last few years have seen pretty dramatic changes. However, a sort of fully autonomous aircraft taking off, in my mind, is still some distance away, despite a lot of sort of proof of concept things. There's a lot of complicated things if you're going to be flying at any distance from your base. I guess I'll wrap up with that. Yeah, there's plenty more to talk about, but I'll.
Tara?
Oh, I thought it was going to be Rosa. Well, it's very nice to be here. I'm glad you guys are all here. And I have to say, it's nice to have the cameras built into the walls. I came back from London, where I was for 2 weeks, and there were cameras everywhere, CCTV cameras. And I was at the CIA yesterday, lots of cameras there. I lost my sweater when I was at the CIA, and they found it for me quickly. So that's one of the advantages of being watched. You feel like you're taken care of. Which leads me to the subject of drones and the Obama administration. My goal when I started working on this chapter or the research in this area was to look at the question of liberals and the Obama administration and how they've responded to their counterterrorism policies. So a year or so after Obama was elected, I was having dinner with some people in New York, and one of them was a human rights activist. And I asked her about the counterterrorism strategy, how she felt about it, and she said, waterboarding is out, drones are in. And I was a little bit surprised when she said that, also kind of the glib nature of the statement. So I asked her to explain a little bit more, and she said, oh, I'm very sorry, you can't quote me on that. And she also said that, unfortunately, nobody in her office was really willing to talk about their feelings about the Obama strategy. So I started to look into sort of the conflict between liberals and the Obama administration and their support for the president and some of the policies that he was doing, not the drones that were run by the military, but the drones that are run by the CIA. That's a separate program, as you guys talked about in the former discussion. And I focused my work in the chapter on Harold Koh. I chose him because he used to be the dean of Yale Law School, and he was also one of the leading voices in international law and also human rights. When he was a critic of the Bush administration, he talked about a targeted killing program that had been discussed or had been underway under the Bush administration and described it as extrajudicial killings and also as assassination. Once he became the legal advisor for the State Department, it was a job he had dreamed about for many years, he changed his views. So my chapter looked at how someone changes their mind, what goes into that process. And that's what I wrote about, and I'm hoping you guys will have questions.
Rosa.
That's it, okay. Well, thanks, Daniel, for organizing this, and thanks to all of you for coming out at a lunchtime event at which we are not feeding you, which is particularly cruel. I've been writing about drones for several years now. I'm not quite sure how I started writing about this, but somehow I became a person who writes about drones. And so it's hard for me to know quite what to say because I've said too much. But let me. Start by, I'll tell you about a task force I was recently on through the Stimson Center here in DC, convened a expert high-level task force on U.S. drone policy, and I was co-chairing it together with General John Abizaid, the former commander of CENTCOM, And the other task force members included John Bellinger, who was the legal advisor to the State Department during the Bush administration. It had also been the Bush's National Security Council legal advisor, Jeff Smith, a former general counsel of the CIA, retired Lieutenant General Dave Barno, and a number of other folks with technology, military, intelligence community backgrounds. And one of the things that we really struggled with from doing a report on U.S. drone policy was that sort of threshold question that's already come up today. What are we actually talking about? What are we interested in here? I mean, drones, you know, you can use drones to, you know, crop dusting. You can use drones for search and rescue. You know, Amazon's going to soon be delivering your packages via drone. You can use drones to provide close air support. It's probably not too far in the distant future that we'll be able to use drones for transporting battlefield casualties, for instance, in situations where it might be too dangerous to send in manned aircraft with medics and so on to get people out when they're in a dangerous situation. Obviously, as Mike has mentioned also, they can provide the exact equivalent of the kind of close air support that manned aircraft could provide in a combat setting, only with less risk to a human pilot. We pretty quickly decided that we weren't actually interested in any of those issues, which we don't think present anything really new. I mean, I think, and again, this has already come out, there are a ton of red herrings in the discussion about drones. You know, it is in many ways, it is just another tool. It is something that flies around. You don't have to have a human in it. It can do a bunch of stuff. It can look at things. It can drop stuff off. It can drop a bomb. It can take pictures, whatever. And there's really nothing new here. So we spent a lot of time trying to kind of get a handle on what is it that is bothering people, what bothers us, what should bother us. We very much ended up sharing the view that Michael's already articulated, which is the problem is not civilian casualties. You know, on the contrary, there's no particular reason to think that drones, however used, create more civilian casualties than other means of dropping things that blow up on people. In fact, there are lots of reasons to think that they're far greater precision. You know, they enable us to do a better job of discriminating between civilians and combatants in a battlefield setting and elsewhere. And there's always been one of the things that was sort of interesting as we began to research this. There's historically always been anxiety about new long distance weapons, and as others have said, you know, that's what you look for on the battlefield. Everybody's always trying to gain some advantage. How can we get the enemy while exposing our own forces a little bit less? Every significant advance in long distance weapon systems has generated a lot of anxiety and backlash. And, you know, going back to the Second Lateran Council, which prohibited under anathema the unchristian crossbow, the murderous art, the villainous art of crossbowmen. You see Cervantes' Don Quixote raising questions about artillery, a devilish invention that permits a base cowardly hand to essentially drop munitions on the bravest gentleman from who knows whence. And in all sorts of ways, historically speaking, innovations in long-distance weapons have been tied up with really pretty significant social and political shifts. You know, the longbow and the crossbow, in many ways, are connected to upending the chivalric social order because suddenly ordinary peasants without a whole lot of training can pierce the metal armor of knights, rendering them much more exposed on the battlefield. Everybody gets very confused. So what we ended up saying is, on the one hand, you know, it's important to see drones as in this context of weapon systems innovations create anxiety and they can facilitate and enable real social transformations. So they're not new in that sense. On the other hand, you know, major political and social transformations are major political and social transformations, and you need to pay attention to them. So we zeroed in on drones as a technology that does not cause, but certainly enables or facilitates a set of practices by states and soon by other actors that would be a lot harder, would be more expensive, more complicated, more risky in a variety of ways if this technology were not available for policymakers to use. And specifically, we focused in on the use of drones at the moment by the United States for cross-border targeted killings outside of what we increasingly refer to as so-called hot battlefields, e.g. Afghanistan, Iraq, et cetera. So I'm talking about the use of drones to strike individuals in places such as Yemen, Somalia, Pakistan, where we don't have ground troops engaged, but we are doing this very individualized target selection and then attempting to kill people using this particular technology. We could do that without drones. You know, we could send in special operations forces, for instance, and sometimes we do. But that's much riskier. It's riskier to our own people. In some ways, there's actually a greater risk of civilian casualties when you get a messy ground situation, et cetera, et cetera. Drones, again, as I said, you could do this without them, but it's riskier. So once we have this technology, we have done it more and more. And Peter Bergen has been one of the people who's been really instrumental in helping us understand the scale and the scope of the U.S. Targeted killing program, primarily using drones. We don't know. Almost all of this is still covert. But the best estimates of triangulating publicly available information suggest that probably about 4,000 people have been killed by U.S. drone strikes in the last decade, you know, give or take. We really don't know. And what this Stimson Center task force ended up feeling very, very strongly, and it was actually, I was pleasantly surprised, you get these sort of bipartisan groups. We started off thinking, gosh, we may not be able to reach consensus. There just may be, you know, too much disagreement. People such as myself, originally with a background in human rights, people such as Phil Mudd, with background at the CIA and the FBI, you know, we're never going to be able to agree. But one thing that was actually kind of a pleasant surprise was how quickly the group did reach consensus on a lot of discomfort, a lot of concern about the targeted killing policy the U.S. has been engaged in. And I just to very, very quickly summarize the areas of concern, and then I'll talk a little bit more about one of them in particular. We were concerned about potential erosion of sovereignty norms as we have this technology that enables the sort of cross-border uses of force and makes them cheaper and easier and more deniable. We were concerned about blowback. Even if if you do kill civilians, there will be blowback. Even if you don't, you know, terrorists have friends and families too, who don't particularly like it when their relatives end up, you know, dead because of something that came down out of the sky, and it can cause tremendous resentment, which can in fact increase extremist recruiting and increase long-term threats against the U.S. We were concerned about slippery slopes towards ever widening, more perpetual conflicts, that as you sort of lower the perceived costs of using cross-border force in this way, it becomes tempting for policymakers to think, oh, what the heck, let's do it one more time. You know, that precisely because in the situations where you might say, cost-benefit analysis, it's not worth sending in special operations force, not worth sending in human beings who might get caught, who might get killed, might be a total political mess, it wouldn't be deniable if they get caught. You might think, oh, what the heck, we could send in a drone, why not? You know, it's deniable. So you do it more often because it's perceived as cheaper and easier, which in turn, you know, how much do you end up drifting without really quite noticing into a kind of ever-widening conflict? We were also very concerned about what we saw as just the lack of strategic analysis, the lack of any real effort on the part of this administration to say, so when you net it out, are we gaining or are we losing here from this set of policies? You know, is this making us safer or is this making us less safe? And it's not particularly clear, I think, to any of us that we were strategically ending up better off, that we were very, very good at dropping bombs on the people we wanted to get, sending missiles to the people we wanted to get. We were not very good at figuring out whether, in the long run, this was reducing the threats to the United States from extremist groups or not. And I think many of us ended up feeling like the answer to that is probably no. This may be making our sort of longer-term national security situation significantly more precarious rather than less so. And there certainly didn't seem to us to be a sufficient systematic effort to evaluate this. The other concerns we had, and those were more strategic concerns, had to do with, I suppose, what you could call the law and ethics, had to do with the lack of transparency. I mean, I think one thing that really kind of felt like sort of a little shocking, a little bit morally shocking to that whole group of people, was the United States has in effect been in a covert war for more than 13 years. 4,000 dead people is a lot of dead people. Only a tiny fraction of those strikes have been acknowledged by the United States, which gets us into a lot of concerns about accountability, about democratic accountability, and about rule of law accountability more broadly. And I think we get very, and I say this as a law professor, it's nice for things to be legal, but we often get really confused about the difference between law and rule of law, right? And I would put it to you that there are things that are more important than lawfulness, and that is consistency with really core rule of law norms. And here's the corest of the core rule of law norms. I'll quote our own Declaration of Independence, right? This is why the U.S. split away from Britain, rebelled violently against Great Britain back in 1776. We started off our declaration by saying we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, including the rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And we detailed a series of incursions by the King of England, George III, on essentially the unaccountable use of lethal and coercive power. And the most sort of core rule of law principle is that, we said these are unalienable rights of, we said men, humans. Today we call them human rights, right? Not because of their nationality, right? But because they are human. If somebody is going to kill you, you should know why. The exercise of lethal force should be rule bound. And there should always be accountability. There should be no unaccountable uses of lethal force, period. Not by nobody, not by any government power. And the lack of that accountability is what made us split off from Great Britain. Here's the fundamental problem with the use of drones outside of hot battlefields and sort of the targeted killing context. We don't have any of that. As Chris said earlier, if you're in Yemen, you don't know what's going to get you killed. You don't know what pattern of behavior, what set of networks, what set of triangulated intelligence is going to lead to you being identified as someone who is targetable. It's sort of unknowable because at the moment the organizations that we regard as targetable, the behaviors that we regard as sufficient evidence of belonging to those organizations or as posing a threat, this is all still in the covert. At the moment, the legal analysis engaged in by the U.S. government to justify these strikes is still has not been disclosed publicly. The process is still not public. We know more about some parts of it than about other parts. We don't know. The evidence that leads to an individual being targeted is of course classified. The fact that the U.S. engages in the strikes and somebody ends up dead is not, by and large, even acknowledged by the U.S. government or our role in it. And so there is no mechanism whatsoever, either for the individuals who are affected or for the rest of us as American citizens or elsewhere in the world, to say, wait, but maybe you made a mistake or you got that wrong or somebody who shouldn't have gotten killed got killed or... this whole process is messy. There's nothing you can do about it. And that to me, and I think for all of us on that Stimson task force was the thing that was just so deeply troubling was this sense of a covert killing program. You couldn't even really say, is it war, is it not war? How do you even begin to evaluate that? How do you begin to know, and here I would differ a bit from Chris in saying that the Geneva Convention sort of answered these questions. I think we don't know what law is applicable because we don't even have the information that we would need to come to any consensus on should we call this a war, should we call this not a war? And that actually matters enormously, right? Because the legal regime governing armed conflicts and the legal regime governing not armed conflicts are really different. And things that are lawful, we think are moral and lawful in a war, we think are unlawful and immoral when you're not in a war. It makes this fundamental difference, and I'll end with my visual aid, which I have here, which I like to pull out.
you know, the humans are categorizers. We like to put things in boxes. We have war over here and we have not war. Every human society has tried to draw those distinctions because the rules are really different. So if we're in an armed conflict with Al-Qaeda and its associated forces, wherever they may be in Yemen, Somalia, et cetera, and if we're, you know, can correctly identify who is part of those groups and who's a civilian, who's a combatant, then these drone strikes are lawful wartime targetings of enemy combatants, no problem. If we are not in a war, then there are unlawful extrajudicial killings, they're murders, they're assassinations, whatever you want to call them. Given that the whole program is covert, we don't know how to evaluate that, but it matters enormously. So here's my visual aid, and some of you may recognize this. Everybody know what this is? Whoops, wait, it went away again. Went away again. It's going to be like a picture of my kids, but everybody know what this is? What's this?
Duck.
It's a duck?
Rabbit.
It's a rabbit. It's Ludwig Wittgenstein's famous duck rabbit, which, depending on your perspective, is either manifestly a duck or manifestly a rabbit. And you can, you know, look at it as long as you want, and it will not reveal itself more distinctly to be one or the other. That's kind of the really deep problem we have right now, and that's, I think, the meta issue raised by not only drones but a variety of other technological transformations, social transformations in warfare. We don't know anymore what a war is, you know, and I could look at, you know, we could equally, just as I could say, it's a duck, look, it's a duck, clearly it's a duck. I wouldn't necessarily be wrong, I wouldn't be lying, I'd point out little, you know, it quacks, it's got a beak. Or I could say, no, it's a rabbit, it's clearly a rabbit, I could point out its ears. When you look at many of the individuals who've been the targets of U.S. drone strikes, you could say it's a war and they're combatants, or you could say it's not a war and they're not combatants. It's not clear what basis we have for saying who's right and who's wrong, particularly when so much is shrouded in secrecy at the moment. That, I would put to you, is the really deep problem. The goal of keeping that distinction between war and not war, even though it's, you know, it's always changing, always adapting our laws, et cetera, is that we want war to be the exception, not the norm, because we want this permissive set of rules that say, yes, it's okay to use lethal force state without due process, et cetera. We want that to be the body of law that governs in the exception, not the body of law that governs altogether. And when the exception sort of eats the norm, when we can't tell the difference anymore, when the government won't give us the information we need to tell the difference, that, I think, is when we really start having problems. And I think that, you know, for both for me personally and for this whole Stimson task force, ended up issuing a report in the summer, which I urge any of you who are interested in this to take a look at, the Stimson Center Task Force on Drones. You just Google it, it'll pop up. Was the really deep problem that troubled us, the same problem Ambassador Volker pointed out. You know, it's not about the technology. It's about a series of policies and practices that have been enabled by this technology that I think we all end up feeling are really undermining the U.S. commitments to core rule of law norms. And I will stop there. Thanks.
Okay, so let's just take a couple of questions from folks in the audience, and then if you want to buy some books, then they're there to be purchased. Mike.
As we have candidate Obama stepping into office, as you know, rated by a number of groups as one of the more liberal senators in the Senate at the time, and arguably probably very concerned with all of the things that Rosa just laid out, what changed? You know, I mean, now we have access to the intel. But we have all of those concerns, and we essentially keep the program as it was under the Bush administration, yeah, and then accelerate it.
Yeah, that's right. That's
why?
That's a very good question. I mean, a couple things. Obama, as a liberal, had this need to prove himself on the national security front, right? So that's one argument for what happened. And also, Obama never said, you know, he said even during the campaign that he was going to go after bin Laden and Pakistan, that he was going to do things unilaterally. So he made it clear early on that he was going to be hardcore about this strategy. And in that way, he was different from Bush. But the people who were at the CIA and who had been involved in the drone program under Bush, they were surprised at how enthusiastic Obama was with the CIA-run drone program. So, you know, it's a question, like a lot of things in Washington, it may be years before we have the whole answer.
Thanks.
questions out in the audience? Yes, please. You can also say who you are as before the question.
Hi, my name is George Peeler. I'm a lawyer and freelance writer. Following up on Mike's question, is there any correlation that anyone has detected between the prevalence of using both covert and overt drone strikes to take people out and the withdrawal of U.S. forces from Iraq and Afghanistan? Is a substitute war increasing with that means, or is that not a factor?
I mean, there's people who are more steeped in this stuff than I am, but what I've been told is that as the U.S. troops come home from Afghanistan, the drone strikes will go down in that area because the reason for the drone strikes is no longer there, protecting the U.S. troops.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's, as this point has been made repeatedly in the book and today, the sort of distinction between a particular technological tool and a policy, like, you almost might as well ask, you know, is there a distinction between, you know, the amount of bullets spent and troop levels? Like, yeah, there is. But does that mean that, you know, the guns have some sort of, like, causal link? Like, they're a tool of war, as is any other. So, and again, you mentioned drone strikes. I think we can't drive home the point enough of just how extremely different, which has been said before, the use of drones in Afghanistan and in Pakistan is. They're doing two fundamentally different things.
I do think, though, the only thing I would add to that is that I think it is pretty clear that the White House, to some extent, regards drone strikes as a better means of protecting U.S. national security interests than ground troops, that they're cheaper. If they get shot down or they break, it's not a dead person. And that there has been, I think, a tendency, which I think is mistaken, to think that they will somehow be a substitute for actually having boots on the ground, or for some sort of harder conversations about what's actually in our strategic interest anyway. But so I do think that we are not likely to see an end to the use of that kind of cross-border drone strike as we withdraw troops further from Afghanistan and reduce their role there. I think we, you know, in the coming decade, we'll probably see more rather than less of that.
So, as I understand, we're withdrawing, but also putting some new troops in. And I wonder if that correlates to the point the last panel made about human intelligence being critical to effective use of this, both for surveillance and for warfare.
I'd like to just bring up one sort of related point that has to do with sort of the project, the book, and all of this loop together, which is when New America, when Peter Bergen and the team, some of whom are here, started gathering information from publicly available sources, it was at a time when drone strikes weren't even being openly acknowledged, particularly we're talking about in Pakistan and then later in Yemen and Somalia. And what this show, what's fascinating, right, is over a period of time, by using publicly available sources, the project here at New America and frankly a few other projects around the world have added to a public understanding and debate some substantive data from which we can pull out patterns. And it's really quite an extraordinary accomplishment. It's not as if all this material has been provided by the government for open review. That's not how we know about this. Interestingly, in relationship somewhat to what you're saying, we've seen, for example, a pretty significant drop in the number and percentages of civilian casualties, say in Pakistan, since this material started to get out into the public. That doesn't prove causality as to what exactly led to that change, and the data isn't perfect. But what it does suggest is something that's quite central to, like, why we're all here, which is with relatively minimal resources, it turns out that it's possible to substantively contribute to a very real debate that affects things globally. Now, that's something quite extraordinary. So the year of the drone that became the decade of the drone, that's become the Future War Project, and this book has something to do with the capacity to substantively engage public debate, possibly on issues like how drone policy is implemented in a world where, there, as Rosa's point out, there's enormous amounts of secrecy. There's great difficulty in accessing actually what's going on. But what's fascinating is there is really the ability to do something productive. And so really thank all of you to be part of this conversation, this discussion, because it has a substantive real impact. Given the time, I want to close out the panel, and then we'll walk over. And if you want some books, we will gladly sell them and sign copies of them. So thank you all so much for coming.